How do we tell the story of North American modern art? What are some of the subjects and themes that we choose to discuss or emphasize? Where do religion and spirituality fit in terms of how we make sense of the modern art of various North American artists, from the subject of today's symposium, Lauren Harris, to another well-known American modern, Andy Warhol? Warhol made hundreds of pictures of religious subjects throughout his career, including, towards the end of his life, more than 100 paintings and drawings based on Leonardo da Vinci's mural, The Last Supper. Riffing on a cheap 19th century copy of Leonardo's iconic scene of devotion and betrayal, Warhol rendered his pictures in day-glow colors, camouflage, cropped repetitive patterns, juxtaposing images of Christ and his disciples with images of motorcycles, with price tags reading 59 cents and $6.99, with logos for Wise Potato Chips, Dove Soap, General Electric, Camel Cigarettes, and Heinz 57. One painting in the series includes the enigmatic phrase, the Big C. Take it however we can take it. Remaking Leonardo's mural on modern terms, Warhol instilled it with what one art historian described as a new spiritual resonance. Now, Warhol is one of the best known modern artists of the last century. Less well known is that he was an observant Catholic who carried a rosary and a pocket missal, that's a small prayer book, and he went to church every week, sometimes more than once. Raised in Pittsburgh in the Byzantine Catholic or Eastern Rite Church, Warhol sustained his faith as an adult. He decorated his townhouse on East 66th Street with devotional paintings and sculptures and kept a crucifix by his bedside. His mom, who lived with him in his New York townhouse from 1952 until the early 1970s, maintained a small shrine in the home as well. In 1980, Warhol received an audience with Pope John Paul II at the Vatican. On Christmas and holidays, he served meals to the homeless in various churches in New York. Over the course of a prominent and prolific career, Warhol both pictured religious subjects and practiced his religious faith. He wasn't alone. Throughout the 20th century, many Canadian and American moderns, including Harris, Marsden Hartley, Agnes Pelton, Mark Toby, turned to the visual and material cultures of diverse religions as artistic sources and inspirations. So my talk this afternoon considers the religious sources and subjects and experiences that they developed, that they sort of transformed themselves into in personally distinctive styles of spiritual modernism. I'm especially interested in the factors and contexts that shaped the course of modernism in America and also in Canada, and why, until relatively recently, we've tended to overlook the intersections of spirituality and the modern in art history. In fact, analysis of these intersections remains relatively minimal today because of long-standing assumptions that modernism and religion are inherently oppositional. Two different examples here. That modern art, that's what I want, was anti-religious and anti-religion. Now, these sorts of suspicions about religion and especially about religious faith stem from a secularization theory of modernity. Following a developmental or progressive model of Western civilization, secularization theorists cast religion as primitive, as irrational, and distinguished modernism as its opposite, the end result, if you will, of evolutionary advance. As sociologist Max Weber rather woefully conceded in 1918, the fate of our times is characterized by rationalization and intellectualization, and above all, by the disenchantment of the world. Modernism, he elaborated, was marked by the knowledge or belief that there are no mysterious, incalculable forces that come into play. Michael Warner remarks that secularization theory originated as a potent Enlightenment mythology that regarded religion as a primitive remnant. Weber, Emile Durkheim, and other intellectuals deemed the era of religious faith as, what you see up on the screen, immature, superstitious, the dark ages before modernity. I kind of like that bumper sticker on the right. Defining religion in terms of dogma, creed, and deference to church authority, secularization theorists misjudged its shifting meanings in modern times as subjective mystical experience in the individual search for transcendence. Religion didn't disappear in modern times. It was reinvented to fit changing and diverse spiritual needs. Modern art was riddled with artists like Marston Hartley, for example, who were drawn to sacred images and sacred ideas, and with patrons like Alfred Stieglitz, who cultivated their spiritual modernism in sanctified art temples like 291. And we heard a little bit about this New York gallery earlier today. In 1909, Stieglitz gave Hartley his first solo show at this New York gallery, a sacred space of modern art that writer and critic Waldo Frank described as, quote, a religious fact, a little altar at which life was worshiped above the noise of the dead city. Here was a refuge, certain and solitary from the tearing grip of industrial order. Now, to be sure, the religious explorations of many moderns were sometimes dismissed or denounced by critics who insisted that modern art and religion were incongruous, that religion, as per Marxist theory, was the dangerous and distracting opiate of the masses, and as per Freudian and Jungian psychology, was an obstacle to more authentic examinations of the self. Similarly, as new scientific theories emerged in fields from biology to physics, fundamentalist Christian insistence on biblical inerrancy and a God-centered universe were perceived as hopelessly out of touch with modernity, and even ludicrous, as the 1925 Scopes trial certainly revealed. Still, from Stieglitz Circle painters like Hartley to pop artists like Warhol, multiple moderns were inspired by multiple religions and religious sources. Many of them found a mentor in Russian painter and theorist Kandinsky, who was intent on defining a modern art of abstraction informed by personal spiritual experience. Kandinsky, studying various religious currents himself, including theosophy, spiritualism, numerology, metaphysics, the occult, yoga, pagan mythologies, indigenous Slavic cosmologies, I don't even know what half of these are, and Christological symbolism, published on the spiritual in art in 1911, asserting that modern art should be a form of creative transcendence, and that modern artists were compelled by inner necessity toward the spiritual life to which art belongs. Struggling against the limiting conditions of materialism, whereby art was categorized as either representation or decoration, and making art was reduced to commodity production, Kandinsky advised artists to forge spiritually resonant forms of modern art. Translated into English in 1914, Kandinsky's book was widely read and widely identified by numerous modern artists, including Hartley, Stieglitz, Harris, Georgia O'Keeffe, as extremely influential. Aiming to transcend secular, material, and commercial categories, these and other modern artists look to religious subjects, symbols, rituals, as they aspire to their art of spiritual modernism. Now, to be clear, these are not religious artists. To be religious is to believe in a transcendent reality, and for some, to follow the tenets of a particular religion or religious institution. To be a religious artist is to illustrate, affirm, proselytize on behalf of certain religions. One widely recognized artist, religious artist in the past century, is the fellow we see here, Warner Solomon, who is an evangelical Protestant, a Chicago-based commercial illustrator, whose Aryan-centric Head of Christ on the left, modeled on Hollywood headshots, is probably among the most widely reproduced image in the 20th century, 21st century now. Motivated by Christian religious imperatives of mass persuasion, Solomon is not a modern artist. American artists ranging from Hartley and O'Keeffe to Pelton and Toby, however, employed certain religious signs and symbols to mold their versions of modern American art. Some did so to interrogate various religions and raise questions about the presence and purpose of divine authority in modern times. Artists who were religious, like Pelton and Toby, developed styles that embodied their personal beliefs and the felt life of faith. Others, like Hartley, were what I call spiritual seekers, artists who doubted mainstream religious dogma, especially the faith traditions in which they'd been raised, and explored other sacred cultures in their search for self, serenity, and emphatically independent versions of modern art. Disaffected by what they perceived as the restrictions of religious orthodoxy or traditional religious belief, spiritual seekers did not reject religion so much as they sought subjective mystical experiences that were personal and aesthetically liberating. This painting by Hartley, for example, was inspired by the German Christian mystic Jacob Bahm's 17th century book Aurora, and represents the artist's imagined visualization of divine corporeality or the hand of God. Likewise, consider Mark Rothko, who in 1947, after experimenting with different strains of social realism and surrealism, began painting what we see here, dazzling rectangles of color that seem to float or pulsate on the canvas. "I'm not an abstractionist," Rothko insisted in a 1956 interview, adding, "I'm interested only in expressing basic human emotions, tragedy, ecstasy, doom, and the fact that lots of people break down and cry when confronted with my pictures show that I communicate those basic human emotions. The people who weep before my pictures are having the same religious experiences I had when I painted them. And if you are moved only by their color relationships, then you miss the point." I think a lot of modern artists shared Rothko's assertions about art, affect, and religious experience, and proceeded to develop styles that embodied their religious beliefs and the felt life of faith. And if many critics, curators, and historians dismissed these religious underpinnings, especially during the interwar and post-war years, what we sometimes call high modernism, the symposium today represents an important new trajectory toward recovering and rethinking the meaning of religion in modern art. That said, what do we mean by religion? And how, if at all, did modern artists represent or translate their religious faith into their art? By extension, how do we, as outsiders and often as non-believers, see and understand their modern art on these terms? What's the significance of recovering religious belief or spiritual thinking in modern art? Religion constitutes those practices and attitudes, rituals and beliefs that imbue a person's life with meaning by linking her or him to a transcendent reality, with that which is beyond purely immanent or secular experience and understanding. Religion is also understood as a system of belief, Buddhism, Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, Judaism, that provides adherents with understandings of the nature and order of existence, the meaning and purpose of life, moral codes, concepts of the sacred. From the missionary zeal of the Southwestern Spanish Padres and the City on the Hill foundation myth of the New England Puritans to modern strains of New Age spirituality, religion has always been central to the American imaginary. And God We Trust has appeared on American coins since 1864 and on paper currency since 1957. As Karen Armstrong observes, in the United States, the first secular republic, the state has always had a religious aura, a manifest destiny, a divinely sanctioned mission. At the turn of the last century, the U.S. was awash in religious, spiritual, and mystical currents, from Protestantism, Catholicism, and Judaism to a variety of NRMs, new religious movements, including Christian Science, the Church of Latter-day Saints, Jehovah's Witnesses, Seventh-day Adventist, Theosophy, Universalism, Unitarianism, the African-American Holiness Movement, Baha'i, Spiritualism, New Thought, and more. Many of these were represented at the 1893 Chicago World's Fair, where the World's Parliament of Religions was first held, and there was another version held 100 years later. This stunning array of religious choice, writes Lee Eric Schmidt, is evidence of America's robust history of religious liberalism, a smorgasbord of spiritual innovation, conditioned by the nation's strong and continuing deliberation about the meaning of faith and the importance of religious choice in a democratic society. This deliberation has involved multiple parties, too. Just after World War II, Superman was recruited by the Institute for American Democracy to promote religious and racial tolerance and pluralism at a moment of virulent anti-Semitism and racist segregation. As I was putting this together, I was like, I wonder what happened to the Institute for American Democracy? And I'd sure like this Superman to come back to my America. In the 19th century, religious innovators, including poets and novelists, Emerson, Whitman, Harriet Beecher Stowe, politicians and labor reformers, William Jennings Bryan, Eugene Debs, and visual artists similarly espoused expanded understandings of religious faith and spirituality. During the Gilded Age, as art historian Christian Swain has written, artists such as Thayer and Tanner negotiated the affective cultures of religious belief to evoke a new modern art of spiritual consciousness. Their focus on the arts, on fine arts, intimate relationship to religious belief and practice would persist in the 20th century paintings of many spiritual moderns. Modern religious liberalism paralleled new understandings of religion itself on especially inspirational and aspirational terms. Religion, as William James asserted in The Varieties of Religious Experience, was the feelings, the acts, the experiences of individual men in relationship to whatever they may consider the divine. Loosening religion from its theological moorings, James argued that feeling is the deeper source of religion. Questioning conventional notions of America as Protestant, note that this is 1902, James studied a plethora of religious beliefs and sacred practices and privileged them all religion. Importantly, James argued for religion's reconsideration as subjective mystical experience or spirituality, which is typically defined in terms of the individual search for transcendence. But he also oscillated between the words religion, spirituality, mysticism, and the divine, thus endorsing a really mutable, very subjective understanding of American faith. I think this was profoundly modernist, and it was a sort of modernist sensibility that came to be shared by many modern artists. Now, some of them, like Georgia O'Keeffe, engaged religious subjects mainly to assess particular cultural landscapes. In 1929, O'Keeffe spent her first of many summers in northern New Mexico, staying at the Taos home of wealthy art patron Mabel Dodge and painting canvases of the historic San Francisco Church, which we see here at Rancho de Taos. O'Keeffe also depicted the rough wooden crosses that she encountered while hiking in remote regions of the Upper Rio Grande, devotional objects made by Los Hermanos Penitentes, a Franciscan Catholic brotherhood who believed that sin is expiated only through self-inflicted penance, including self-flagellation and crucifixion. As O'Keeffe later told art critic Henry McBride, anybody who doesn't feel the crosses simply doesn't get that country. And as she later related, I saw the crosses so often, and so often in unexpected places, like a thin, dark veil of the Catholic Church spread over the New Mexico landscape. In other words, O'Keeffe's basic interest in New Mexico's Catholic crosses and churches was much like her basic interest in the region's clouds, mesas, and bones. These things embodied the space, the place, the feel of the American Southwest, and feeling is what Georgia O'Keeffe most sought to paint. Hers was not then an explicitly religious modern art, but the work of a modern artist interested in the visibility, the affect of religion in America. Rather than inhabiting or dwelling in any particular religious tradition, spiritual seekers like O'Keeffe and Hartley moved among multiple sacred disciplines as they considered the terms and meaning of belief. Writing to Stieglitz in 1913, Hartley breathlessly detailed, quote, the fragments of mysticism that he had found out of Bam, out of Eckhart, Tauler, Suso, Ruysbroek, the Bhagavad Gita, and it inspired, as he put it, a series of canvases nearly 15, 30 by 40, which those who have seen them say is the first expression of mysticism in modern art. Hartley was not immodest. Now, Raptus, which we see here, is one of these mystically informed canvases, evoking the stained glass interiors of the European churches that Hartley visited while living in Paris and Berlin at this time. Note in the center, he printed the word Raptus, which stems from the Latin for seizure, and implies apocalyptic spiritual overtones, such as the rapture, prophesied in Christian eschatology as the ascension to heaven of true believers during the second coming of Christ. Doing so, he bluntly asserted his visual interest in conveying not only a religious space, but the felt, the experienced conditions of spirituality. Ideas, he later related, he experienced by reading the varieties of religious experience, and in particular, James's account of the rapturous devotional experiences of St. Teresa de Avila, the 16th century Carmelite nun and Spanish mystic. Hartley often alluded to his religious interest in letters, poems, and essays. In his autobiography, he described Emerson's Essays, which we've heard about, a compilation of writings about transcendentalism, self-reliance, and the oversoul, and this was published in 1841. Hartley described this as the holy script that guided his thought, feeling, and vision when he was in his early 20s. He reminisced about carrying a copy of Emerson's book in his pocket and reading it on all occasions as a priest reads his Latin breviary on all occasions. In letters to friends in the early 1900s, Hartley extolled on the real beauties of spiritual life and considered the ministry, becoming an Episcopal priest. He constantly sought diverse spiritual encounters. In 1907, he worked at Green Acre, an interreligious community in Elliott, Maine. In 1913, he moved to Berlin to meet Kandinsky, deeply attracted to the Russian artist's modernist synthesis of pictorial form, spirituality, and affect. And in 1918, he moved to New Mexico for about a year to experience what he romanticized as a more mystically attuned geography culture and people, and in particular, the American Indian, which he had actually fantasized about earlier in paintings that he produced in Berlin, such as this one in 1914. Throughout his career, Hartley's paintings were infused with a visionary point of view, as he described them in a letter to Stieglitz. From early works, which we see here, like Raptus and Resurrection on the right, which depicts a prophetic male figure based on William Blake's visionary watercolors, to these still lifes painted while living in New Mexico and witnessing both Catholic and Native American rituals, Hartley repeatedly inflected his art with spiritual references. His recurrent investment in religious and mystical currents was, in fact, one of the few constancies in Hartley's rather peripatetic life. In his autobiography, Hartley described a female occultist visiting his Paris studio in the early teens and saying to him, "You have no idea what you're doing. These pictures are full of Kabbalistic signs and symbols." But as Charlie Eldridge has written, for Hartley, the goal was not an occult cryptogram, but a suggestion of the spiritual perceived through the self. Less pilgrims on a journey of faith, Hartley and other spiritual seekers were more like tourists who viewed religions as sites to visit, to experience. Many seekers, including Hartley, were agnostic. Less interested in moralizing concerns about right and wrong or sin and salvation, their seeker spirituality was eclectic, it was about yearning, and it was cosmopolitan. As Hartley told the German artist Franz Marc in 1913, "I have no objectified faith, no creed, no dogma, no philosophy. I have only the attitude of the mystical nature which feeds itself into this quality of things as they appear before me." While appropriating a veritable lexicon of religious iconography throughout his art, Portrait of Berlin on the left, for example, features crosses, halos, stars, triangles, which reference the Christian Trinity here, the number 8, a symbol of infinity in occult circles, and a seated Buddha. He's got it all. On the right, El Santo includes a Navajo weaving, a Santa Clara blackware jar, an Hispanic retablo depicting Christ carrying the cross. Hartley didn't follow any of the religious tenets they embodied. He wanted to, he told his niece in 1933, but quote, "it just won't come out." Other moderns, like Marcel Duchamp, the French-born artist who spent much of his career in America, actually becoming a US citizen in 1955, drew on religious ideas and images to challenge ideas about belief and critique the limitations of religious institutions. Raised Catholic, very well versed in mystical literature, Duchamp infused his most significant art project, The Large Glass, with references to alchemy, the occult, tarot, the fourth dimension. And like his revisionist colleague, the Baronist Elsa von Freytag-Loringhoven, who in 1917 took a cast iron plumbing trap, turned it upside down, mounted it on a wooden miter box and called it God, was mostly engaged in an interrogatory understanding of religion, driven by skepticism and iconoclasm. Like Kandinsky, Duchamp was intrigued by early modern art's transcendent possibilities. At the 1949 Western Roundtable on Modern Art, for example, this was a San Francisco symposium that featured all sorts of modernist movers and shakers, including Mark Toby, Frank Lloyd Wright, art historian Robert Goldwater, critic Kenneth Burke. Duchamp argued that modern art was an aesthetic revelation that cannot be understood through the intellect, but is felt through an emotion presenting some analogy with a religious faith. But shortly before he died in 1968, Duchamp told writer Calvin Tompkins, "I've decided that art is a habit-forming drug. That's all it is, for the artist, for the collector, for anybody." Art has no existence as veracity, as truth. People speak of it with great religious reverence, but why? It's a drug, that's all. Disgusted with how modern art had become a religion rather than religious, Duchamp added, "I'm afraid I've become an agnostic in art. I just don't believe in it anymore with all the mystical trimmings. As a drug, it's probably very useful for a number of people, very sedative, but as a religion, it's not even as good as God." Duchamp worked on the large glass for 8 years and then abandoned it, unfinished, unable to create that dynamic aesthetic revelation that he had once believed modern art could be. Many spiritual moderns struggled with the same doubts, but persevered in their individual efforts to generate spiritually resonant forms of modern art. Around 1917, for example, Charles Birchfield began to develop the mystical nature images that would dominate his visionary landscapes well into the 1960s. A professed apostate who detested organized religion, Birchfield once wrote that he saw faith as a battle raging through one's life. His journals, some 10,000 pages in all, repeatedly reference the torment of faith, or of doubt, rather. Inspired by religious sources ranging from Hindu and Buddhist texts to mystical cosmology, Birchfield developed an expressive pictorial language based on the revelations of nature. As he wrote in 1914, "Is it blasphemous to love the drops of dew on the haze-blurred branches more than some formal religious idea? I say it is not. It may be said, these are my Bible, the visible evidence of God." Spiritual modern Agnes Pelton visually constituted her faith in a large series of brightly colored abstract canvases dominated by symbols of rays, moons, and stars. Pelton was a follower of Theosophy, a religious movement founded by Helena Blavatsky in New York in 1875 that anticipated a new age of heightened spiritual consciousness. And we've heard a little bit about Theosophy today. A synthesis of Neoplatonism, occult, Kabbalah, and certain Indian texts, Theosophy's cosmology of a spirit-matter universe centers on harmony, well-being, and self-control. With an emphasis, too, on karma and reincarnation, Theosophy offered an alternative to Western theism and scientific materialism, and was an empowering spiritual substitute for mainstream Christian norms that many modern artists, like Agnes Pelton, found hollow. And it sounds to me, from what I've heard today, that this is very true for Harris as well. Through the early 1920s, Pelton made representational paintings like these. She was a successful New York modern. She was included in the 1913 Armory Show with the painting Vine Wood that we see on the left. Her shows were reviewed, her paintings sold, she knew the right people. She was featured in some of the more important exhibits of the day. In 1921, however, she abandoned her New York studio and retreated to a century-old windmill near the Hamptons on Long Island. And over the next decade, she began painting spiritually attuned abstractions like The Ray Serene, which is inscribed on the reverse, "My first abstraction not for sale." Theosophy counsels that human wisdom and perfection are attainable at various levels or stages, from initiation to planetary logos, via 7 astral rays, also understood as divine light and celestial power. For the rest of her career, Pelton focused on these theosophist principles in her abstractions, a large body of brilliantly colored, highly symbolic canvases with which she aimed to convey, as she said, her light message to the world. We've heard so much about light today, but it's such a signifier for so many of these spiritual moderns. In 1932, she moved to Cathedral City, California, near Palm Springs, where she painted, studied theosophy, and sought out fellow believers. She was close, for example, to Loma Land. This is not a Disney franchise. This was created earlier in 1900. It was a theosophical community put together by Catherine Tingley, a social reformer and editor, built on 500 acres of oceanfront property in Point Loma, San Diego. Oh my God. None of this survives today. In her own little house in Cathedral City, which is such a perfect place for Agnes Pelton to end up, I think, she built a meditation room and practiced rituals involving incense and trance states, which she referenced in her journals and also we see in her paintings. Painting was a devotional practice for Pelton, a means of articulating her theosophist beliefs in modern art. Copying a theosophical passage that reads, "Spiritual transactions must be translated into the language of mortal senses." She noted in her journal, "This is where the form of the natural world must appear in a picture or can do so, not for themselves, but to convey thought as future light." And this sounds so much like some of the Emerson quotes that Peter was reading to us earlier. Pelton repeatedly used symbols of stars, lotus flowers, flames, and especially rays of light to convey her theosophical concepts. More directly, as we've heard as well, she copied images from Thought Forms, that theosophical treatise that was first published in 1901, in which colors and shapes were matched with corresponding emotional and aspirational shapes and states. A blue lotus flower, for example, with self-renunciation, a winged orange form with high ambition. Her painting Night Fires, which we see here, features several of these thought forms, including symbols for jealousy and also for affection. Mark Tobey also shifted to a highly symbolic style of modern art when in 1918 he became an adherent of Baha'i, an offshoot of Islam that envisions itself as a unifying faith for major world religions and advocates the progressive revelation of God through a series of prophets. Tobey was working in New York as a fashion illustrator, hating it, and hanging out at parties with Marcel Duchamp. Duchamp's critical condemnation of the purely visual aspects of art or the limited retinal qualities of painting was a turning point for Tobey, who later recalled that it was after an evening at a party at Duchamp's studio, "I kept wondering if by chance there might be something else greater than art. The idea stayed with me for several days, during which I thought considerably about the expression, the love of God, what it is, what it could mean to someone like myself." Soon thereafter, he was introduced to Baha'i and became an adherent. So his faith was inspired by Duchamp's directive that modern artists should pursue something more, something else greater than representational art. In the 1930s, Tobey began developing the abstract all-over style of painting that we see here. He called it white writing, which he later explained was a unifying idea that flows through the compartmented units of life, bringing a dynamic to men's minds, ever expanding their energies toward a larger relativity. Tobey's white writing was inspired by the rapidly transcribed style of Arabic calligraphy, manifested in the written revelations of Baha'i's 19th century Persian founder, the Baha'u'llah, pages of which Tobey saw while visiting the Shrine of the Bab in Mount Carmel, Haifa in 1932. And here I'm contrasting his agate world with a page of revelation writing done by the Baha'u'llah's scribe, Mirza Akajan, who developed a special form of speed writing that allowed him to transcribe up to 1,000 verses in a single hour. Revelation often continued for days as the Baha'u'llah went into a trance state, uttering verses very rapidly and sometimes chanting in what was regarded as a special heavenly language. A painting such as Canticle, which we see here, with its really subtly rendered yet very frenetic brushwork, its overlay of luminous color, and its title referencing spiritual themes — a canticle is a liturgical song taken from the Bible — embodies Toby's belief in the Baha'i principles of universalism and global unity, and in the mystical and revelatory dimensions of modern visual art. After Toby developed this white writing style, he was widely acclaimed as an important modern artist. In 1946, for example, he was featured in solo shows at the Museum of Modern Art and the Detroit Institute. His faith was never discussed among mid-century art critics, however. Clement Greenberg lauded Toby for what he called his original contributions to contemporary American painting, and he even named him an exemplar of abstract expressionism, but he ignored how Toby's modern art was informed by his religious beliefs. Critical response to Rothko and to Warhol was similar. Their religious beliefs were largely ignored in deference to secular modernism's basic distrust of religion. Yet, consider Warhol's death and disaster paintings of the early 1960s, which were based on tabloid newspaper photographs of car crashes, suicides, electric chairs. These were more than simply contemporary subjects for Warhol. They echoed the crucial meaning of sin, death, and divine judgment in his religion, Eastern Rite Catholicism of the Byzantine, Ruthenian, or Slavic Church. Death and divine judgment were matters of some concern to Warhol, who was a gay artist in a religious faith that denounces homosexuality as gravely immoral. He believed, in other words, that he was doomed to damnation. When he painted Heaven and Hell Are Just One Breath Away, he wasn't being ironic. Even when his dealers failed at that time to sell many of these gruesome paintings, he continued to churn them out. He produced some 1,000 death-related canvases in 1962 alone, which suggest their deeply personal and symbolic meaning. Likewise, towards the end of his life, he produced both the Last Supper series and a series of crosses, minimal, dramatic depictions based on photos of Christian devotional objects, many of which he collected in his own home. The visual evidence of Warhol's art reveals a depth of religious engagement, a kind of spiritual resonance that surely calls for further consideration. As this symposium and this exhibit certainly suggest, modern art's interpretive range is increasingly extensive. Issues in context of race, gender, class, ethnicity, and sexual difference are typically included as salient factors of consideration. Yet studies of the intersections between modern North American art and religion remain minimal. I'd like to argue for more efficacious approaches to the cultural work of religion, and more generous considerations of the links between art and belief in modern times. From acts of interrogation to representations of visual transcendence, artistic intersections with religion, spirituality, and mysticism offer new avenues of inquiry in modernism and modern art. Thank you.